Welcome to the Old Bob Show. Located in beautiful Westby amidst the scenic ridges and coulees of western Wisconsin. And now here's your program host, Bob Burrell, along with his special guests.
Hello and welcome again to the Old Bob Show. The Old Bob Show, as you know, is here because of the wonderful generosity of Vernon Communications and Vernon Tell in Westby. But the Old Bob Show is now being watched not only in around 8,500 homes in the Westby, Viroqua, Coon Valley area, but also down in the Dane County area. And it probably will be seen in some other places as well. That's why we try to have some really good people on this show whose subject matter and whose background can really be resonated with and appreciated wherever you might happen to be. Today, again, we have with us our special guest, Dennis Seilers, who is the manager of Living Waters Bible Camp. And Dennis has been with us twice now, and he's so good, we keep inviting Dennis back. Thank you for being with us, Dennis.
Thank you so much for having me, Bob. Appreciate it.
You're most welcome. Dennis has talked on this show about rocks and several other items. Today, the topic is a very serious one, and it's one that I hope all of you will sit down and listen to, and maybe even jot down a few facts here and there. The topic is parenting. And are you qualified to talk about parenting, Dennis?
Well, maybe, Bob. We have a few children of our own.
Yes.
And our family now has, we have 8 biological children. Bob, we have 3 adopted children. And we have, right now, we have 5 foster children in our house. We just, in the last month, added 2 more grandchildren to the picture that's there. And we have 1 son that's in there that's getting married next month. So I think just from that, Bob, that we're learning. We still don't know anything about parenting, I think, but we're learning.
Well, I tell you what, and looking at this picture, you have a you have an incredible responsibility, you and your wife, and yet you manage this this wonderful Living Waters Bible Camp. So you have a lot of different experiences, and I know, Dennis, that you've brought up or have grown yourself. And I've probably come up with many different concepts about parenting as you've gone along here.
Yeah. Bob, one of the things that has really been helpful for us is my wife and I, about 7 years ago, we made a decision through prayer and through seeing so many friends whose families were hurting that maybe we thought maybe we could help a little. So we started praying of maybe we would help get involved with foster care. And we decided one time that I was at a Bible study. And in that Bible study, there was a verse that's actually in the end of the book of James, and it says, true religion is caring for the widows and the poor, and also the children who didn't have parents.
Right.
And that just broke my heart to realize that the orphans or kids that are having unsafe living conditions, that maybe we could help.
Wow.
And so 2 weeks later, we had foster children in our house.
Wow. So, you know, the great thing about Dennis is that he speaks to the truth from experience. And rather than just speaking to you from out of a book or from other people's experiences. Now, I've got another visual here that I'll hold up, which has honor your father and mother. And I'll hold this up so that Rick Johnson, our cameraman here, can zero in as we're looking at it. And this is right out of the Ten Commandments, Dennis.
So, the first one is right out of the Ten Commandments. Bob, one of the reasons that this has been so powerful for my wife and I is to realize that as parents, we're afraid to parent. We're afraid to tell our children no. We're afraid to really have an opportunity to realize the responsibility and the incredible need that actually children need a parent who's going to teach them to honor their parents. Well, parents, because we're not perfect, we're far from being perfect, that we realize that we don't want to do it. Well, in God's word, it actually gave some encouragement in the Ten Commandments. Bob, even before it says, do not kill, do not murder, do not steal, everybody would be heartbroken if their children were doing that. But the very first commandment is honor your father and mother. That deals with our relationships with people. The first 4 deal with our relationship with God. The very first one dealing with people says, honor your father and mother. Well, Bob, if we don't teach and train our children that they need to honor their father and mother, then how do they honor the policeman, How do they honor their authorities, their teachers? How do they learn to even honor God? It's an incredible challenge for us today.
Oh, absolutely. And you know, you raised the words of training. But along with training goes raising.
Right.
And I've got another visual here for all of you to look at that Dennis has put together here. These are so important, Dennis, especially when you consider here in the state of Wisconsin, according to Appling, 48% of all children are raised in a single family. So here we are now talking about how to be a parent. And
well, Bob, even as you're looking at that one, just to what Julaine said, 48% are not living with a parent, but Bob, over 60% don't live with their biological parent. And then of those 48% that live with a single parent house, the ones that do have parents, dads are busy, and dads they don't even know how to parent anymore because our examples on TV, our examples in culture are gone away. But Bob, with that picture right there, is that's a good one of raising or training.
I'll put that up again
because
here.
we raise cattle in Wisconsin,
right?
Don't we? And what do we raise cattle for, Bob?
Well, you know, if you're kind of like my family, we raise them for good milk.
For good milk?
For nourishment.
And so the goal of raising them is to suck every ounce of milk out of them you get out of them.
Well,
and then to butcher them. We want to eat them for the
know.
Meat.
Well, now you're on a sore subject with me, Dennis, because, you know, we have a milk cow and a bull calf and all that. I just can't imagine butchering that bull calf. But it's going down. And when you talk about raising versus training, raising implies love.
Well, raising, and we look at it different, is that raising means you put them out in the field, mm-hmm. you feed them, but you train horses.
Okay.
And what do we train horses for? This picture shows the training of horses to pull a carriage. But we also train horses to race. We train them to drive, maybe to take logs out of the woods. And Bob, when we train, the thing is that you look at the size of the horse, the speed of the horse, the strength of the horse, and then the owner trains it for what? For the use of the master. Mm-hmm. And so when it's properly trained, it gets full benefit out of it to be able to do what it's designed to do. And Bob, with training children today, we have gotten to the point where we put them out in pasture, take from them, hope that they grow up being good, and expect them to be good, but it doesn't happen unless there's training. To prove that, in Westby, there's a lot of good sports teams. And in other cities, there's great sports teams. But you know what? They don't get that way just by having them hang out in the dugout with other good players. Mm-hmm. They go because they have great coaching. And great coaching can take great or well-designed athletes to do their job, to work together for the glory of the team. Well, Bob, we want to train children. We want to train our children to be able to raise them up for the glory of the master, the glory of their families.
There you are.
And that's just an incredible.
And the glory, when you say the glory of the master, you are referring to God.
Amen.
You bet. Amen is right. Doing. Well, you know, I just can't help but commend you for all of these good things you and your wife and family and all your children are doing, because they in turn have learned how to be trained. And they learn the process and the practicalities of good training. And all of that comes along with the good raising of character.
Well, you've got to put in good food and good nourishment into them, but then you have to train them up in the way that they should go.
I'm talking with Dennis Seiler, who is the manager of Living Waters Bible Camp right near Westby, about 3 miles from Westby down the road here. And this week, when I'm talking to you, it happens to be on July 16th today. Dennis, you told me you had about 500 children?
Well, this week we have about 80 children at
80
camp.
80 children at camp.
And then plus the staff.
150.
150,
that's what I was thinking.
And this Saturday morning we'll have almost 300 for breakfast because the parents come in to pick up their children, and
wow,
it's just a great time together.
Wow. How do you handle that kind of nourishment?
Well, the staff had a good meeting yesterday to figure out where they're going to put them all. But
there you are.
They're looking forward to it.
That's all part of our topic here today with Dennis Seiler, which is parenting, training, and raising. So we go to the next one. I have Dennis brought some wonderful visuals here. Four goals of training children, and I'll hold that up here. And Dennis, you can kind of go down the line here as we look at this. This could apply to any family, right?
This applies to every family. And my wife and I do need to give a lot of credit to the foster system in Wisconsin, because my wife and I, we get training through the Christian camping, we get training through schools, and I go to conferences for schools. But the foster system, my wife and I get a lot of great training through the foster system in the state. And so some of these ideas are from Scripture, and some of these are right from the foster training system, which we're really thankful for. But this first one is, you know, when you're training up children, one of the problems that we struggled with as young parents, and that many families struggle with, is we don't even set goals for our children. And these goals, if you look at them, that we want to teach our children, train our children to have self-control, to have godly wisdom or wisdom, to be responsible and to serve others. And if we don't do that, Bob, whether they're Christians, whether they go to church or not, what do we have in society? We have a society that says what? I don't really care where my kids go. And I don't think any parent really says that. But parents don't realize that without a goal for the children, we don't know what to put them in, what to say yes to, what to say no to. And whether a child is 2 years old, 5 years old, 10 years old, we have this incredible opportunity to what? Do I want a two-year-old child that doesn't have self-control, that throws a fit in the store? And Bob, actually, when we go into the stores, that's what was a big motivator for me to realize that we've got to help more parents, because you go in, kids are grabbing at the candy, grabbing at the toys, crying because they don't get it. We've even seen a 15-year-old girl who said, "Dad, if you don't get me this computer today, I'm not coming to visit at Christmas." And so 10 minutes later, we saw the girl walk out of the store with the computer. And so what did she do?
Wow.
She didn't stop till she got it. She kept crying and blowing up. And so we want 2 years old, 5 years old, 10 years old to have self-control. We want them to have godly wisdom, or learn how to make good, wise decisions. And then we want to teach them to be responsible.
I'm going to hold this up again here so we can look at these.
How many employees today would love to have young people who are responsible, that show up, that take responsibility for their actions and their words? And then finally, if we don't train children to serve others, that means sharing when they're 2 and 5 years old. That means serving others, and we see that more and more today, but to serve others throughout their lifetime. It doesn't start when they become teenagers. It needs to start when they're 2, 3, 4, 5 years old, so that they can learn these attitudes that affect them for a lifetime.
You know, those are wonderful goals, and they're so basic. Each one works together to help a person really become independent in life. Being able to follow all these and, you know, serving others. You and I both know, I see young children or young people who suddenly come out and want to do something for you, mm-hmm. or say thank you for something, or run off without being told to do something. You said, wow, is that ever great? And so consequently, that young person has more advantages going for it already, because adults will favor that.
We all like that. And you know what? You learned that, Bob, when you were young and you didn't even realize it.
That's exactly right.
Your mom and dad, it was ingrained in you to serve your neighbors, to help your neighbors who are in trouble. And you stopped what you were doing to go help somebody else who had a need. And we're so busy today that we don't have time to help others.
Exactly. So self-control, godly wisdom, responsibility, serving others. That comes mostly from the father and mother, but also from the activities that they are important for their children. We're going down to Stoughton or Madison next year or two to go to a little Bible camp where our grandchildren are going to be.
Okay.
With a mother. And we're kind of looking forward to that. How about you? Did you experience these, Dennis, when you were a young man?
Well, I did a lot of them, Bob. The interesting thing is, when I was 12 years old, my dad got in a bad car wreck, shoved his leg bone through his pelvic, broke all his ribs. And we just had this incredible challenge of that point at 12 years old that the four of us older siblings had to take over getting enough money somehow for our family.
Yeah.
And so so we were forced into an early maturity, which today I don't regret, but at the time it was really, really hard.
Oh, I believe it. I believe that. I'm a farm boy, and so I had a real advantage because I grew up learning how to work before I could hardly walk. Mm-hmm. But it was a wonderful environment because, I never thought it was work. I loved doing it and working with my parents. And so I was very lucky because somehow they had a psychology that motivated all of us to be that way.
And if you didn't work, you didn't have to worry because you didn't get to eat then either.
That's for sure. Dennis Seiler's manager of the Living Waters Bible Camp is my guest, and we're talking about parenting. And for all of you out there, whether you're parents, grandparents, parents-to-be, aunts or uncles, or just bystanders, what Dennis has to say to all of you is broken down into some wonderful, very basic categories. And, kind of jot them down if you can in case you're talking to someone or you yourself are a parent. Children have responsibilities, and that's one of the reasons of training and raising children is to help them learn the word responsibility. So if children have responsibilities, how about the parents?
Well, Bob, parents are struggling to be parents today. And this is some help that we've got through the foster system for caregivers, is that for a young child to grow up and to have a trusting relationship, to be able to explore, to be able to discover, they need parents or caregivers that are able to be bigger or sufficient, to be stronger, to be wiser, and to be loving. And so bigger and sufficient, that means, not that I'm bigger, I'm obviously a little bigger than the average guy, but that it's not that type of bigger, it's bigger than the problems that are in the children's lives. To be sufficient, That type of bigger and sufficient is that I'm sufficient in who God made me. I'm sufficient that God made me who I am as a parent, as an individual, so that I don't have to live my desires in childhood out through my child. It's great that kids are in sports. It's great that kids can get jobs and things. But when a parent says, you know what, I never got to be that great athlete, I want to make my child that. I never was pretty, so I want to put my child to be someone who can be the beauty queen or the princess mm-hmm. in town. And so when we look at that, we have that incredible opportunity to realize that if the parent isn't sufficient, and Bob, I went to a class on adolescence one time, and that was just 3 years ago, and they were saying that the 26-year-olds today are still in late adolescence. And you know what that means? Is it means that late adolescence means that they're still not willing to give up their self. They're still not willing to serve others before so. They're still not willing to take responsibility for themselves, let alone others. And we have people that are parenting that are still in late adolescence, haven't got to the mature parent level in their life. And then we wonder why there's so many struggles with training their children or even raising their children.
Sure.
But so the first one is to be bigger, stronger. The second one is stronger. And if we're not stronger, Bob, that means just like the dad that was in the store that the daughter, kept pushing and pushing to what she wants. And that's normal in all of us to try to get what we want. But when we have a parent that breaks down because of a child whining who's a baby, and so I give them candy or I give them something, yeah. Well, it teaches them that I can keep whining to get what I want. And then a parent has to be wiser to the sense of, can I think about what my child needs next year? Can I think about that?
Well, how about this situation where, I go back to many scenes come quickly to my mind. One is when Jeannie and I were in a grad school, and I was looking down out on the lawn, mm-hmm. and here is a mother with maybe a 2.5, 3-year-old child trying to explain to her why she should be doing something. Well, obviously, the child at that time, her language facility wasn't all that much. In my home, for example, there wasn't explaining. There was just taking of the hands that you don't do this.
Right.
And, You answer, whatever. And many parents are, my parents, right, and probably, right. When you lost your dad, but boy, these parents had painful times. They were raising a depression. There was no money. They lost a child. They this and that and so forth. You know, did they buckle under? No, they just kind of girded themselves. And one of the strong elements in all that was their faith.
Very much so.
And we talk about the father, you know, missing in the family. There's another father that was very much in my mind as to why I really had to be as a decent young man and a decent boy. That's part of your home training too.
Oh yeah. Well, and when we were young, you knew that somebody else above you was watching you even when you weren't.
Yeah, that's exactly right. It's a good way to put that. And you know, if it wasn't above, it was the next door neighbor looking.
And your neighbors helped you.
they did, very much so. Oh yeah, I mean, if you did something, you know, the phone would ring. I mean, if you did something down the road, you know, phone would ring and say, you know, I don't know, Robert. And boy, families knew about what their children were doing, which is maybe, that might have been a little cocoon, but today a lot of that is missing. We don't have watching neighbors,
right,
do we?
And it's afraid everybody doesn't feel like I can tell you something, mm-hmm, because we believe this verse. It's taken out of context as judge not unless you be judged also.
You bet.
But Bob, one of the things with the parenting responsibility today is you can be bigger, stronger, and wiser, but there's parents that are bigger, stronger, and wiser sometimes aren't loving.
Right.
Bob, a parent that's not loving their children, that really is a huge challenge, because if you have a parent that doesn't love and yet you're trying to guide, you don't feel the desire to want to do, to want to serve.
That's a great motive. It's such a motivator in your personal relationships with not only your children but with your wife or your husband, with good friends. You know, there's that affirming dimension or affirming feeling, emotion, yeah, that comes from love.
Yeah. It's just so important today, Bob. And again, if the thing with the parent responsibility, if you're not bigger, stronger, wiser, and loving, I want you to know that being a mature parent is not really possible unless you're all four.
Yeah.
You can't say, well, I'm bigger and stronger and loving, but I'm not wiser, because then I have a child that's going off and making silly decisions that could have been stopped,
yeah,
if I would have had a smarter parent.
Yeah. Well, you know, that thing about, being a father but not being there, mm-hmm, and our mother not being there, and they're not in the home, and consequently, children get lonesome. And they're striving for love. They're yeah, looking for it.
But they need it. They're going to get it somewhere.
Yeah.
And Bob, when you look at those parents that Jelaine was talking about, when you look at that many parents without children, well, or children without their dads living in the home, or a dad, well, then of the ones that are, they're so busy that they're not necessarily doing a great, yeah, job either.
Well, we have, Dennis, we have one more visual here called the four C's of training.
This is one everybody likes, Bob.
I'll hold this one up. Good. All
this
right.
Is one. And this is the one everybody's looking for, because this is the how-tos. Now, we're only going to take 2 minutes here, but this is a full hour to learn some of these things. But Bob, at the end of the day, when I have some practical how-tos, I need to remember that as training up a child, I need to be clear. I need to be clear whether they're 2 years old or 10 years old or 20 years old. I need to be concise. Just like you said with that mother talking to the child, I see that so many times over and over again.
Yeah.
Let's explain to a 2-year-old or a 3-year-old, Bob, until a child is 5, there's not a lot of long explanations required. It's pick up toys and to be concise, pick up toys, not pick up your toys because tomorrow grandma and grandpa are coming and we need to have our room clean and dot, dot, dot.
Right.
So it's pick up your toys now. And then, so we need to be concise and we need to be consistent. Bob, I see this a lot, even with my own wife and I. By the way, I could tell you all the problems of child training because of my bad training of my children sometimes. And so with that, Bob, that we need to be consistent between the husband and the wife, mm-hmm, between the mom, not when you're happy 1 minute, sad when you're the other minute. And so because I'm happy, I let things go. When I'm sad or mad, I get mad at things. A child doesn't understand. And Bob, with the consequences, I need to make sure that we're consistent, that they fit. We ground a kid for a week because they spilled their milk. And the next time they throw their milk at somebody and we laugh at them. And Bob, we need to be clear, concise consequences.
It's been a great pleasure, Dennis, to have you with me today and to be talking about parenting with just a wonderful breakdown of all the different, the four C's of training, for example, and training and raising and so forth. And I'm hoping that this will be seen by a lot of people. And if you wish, you can check in at the end of the show, look at the credits for whom you can contact on this. So this week, Dennis Seilers has been with me again on Parenting. Next week, Charles Norton, Chuck Norton, who is superintendent of schools, I think, in the Westby area here. He is going to talk about the state of Wisconsin, education, budgets, core curriculums. We're going to have some real issues there, Dennis, when we're at it. Meanwhile, all of you have a good week, and don't forget about parent responsibilities, child responsibilities, the four C's of training, but the biggest thing is love and respect and responsibility.
Bob, thank you. And to let you know that my wife and I actually do free parent training conferences anywhere in the Midwest.
Okay, all right.
If your area or church would like to have us.
And we'll have the credits on the end here so people would know what to call.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thanks for being with us on the Old Bob Show. I'm looking forward to being with all of you again a week from now. Chuck Norton will be with us, and we're going to have a good hoedown on that, I think.
Have a great day.
You have a great day, too.
You've been watching The Old Bob Show on your community channel. Check your guide for other Old Bob programming, and have a good day.